Hello, friends. I'm Larry, and I'm at the Portland Roaster Show, and I'm here with Doug Graff. Doug, nice to meet you.
You too, Larry.
Well, this will be an interesting thing. I always ask people about your specific car. Usually it's a straightforward answer. Well, I got a 69 Camaro, or I got a, you know, an 84 this. You got something that's kind of a combination of a lot of years and a lot of stuff that hasn't even been built. Give me a little rundown on the overall, what it is and where you've gone with it.
The car we have here at the show this weekend is a combination of a 2013 427 Corvette. Not a true Z06, but it's a factory 427 dry sump engine Corvette that was purchased brand new from the dealer. And then we retrofit a 67 style body onto that car. And it sounds a lot easier than it is. There's a lot of background work, years of research and development that went into it. The molds were cut on a CNC machine. It was all done digitally in a computer before it was actually put on the car. So everything works on the car. All the features of the original car, the power top, navigation, heated seats, traction control, braking, everything from the original car is still intact, still works just like it did as a new car, and it just makes for such a great, dependable driver.
I mean, I don't know any Corvette enthusiast that doesn't want that. Now, I won't say there's the purist guys that'll go, well, it's not of this or it's not of that. In my opinion, yeah, it's better. I mean, I'm getting the best of everything that I want. One of the big challenges I saw, at least visually, it seemed to me, I don't see how you get your math here when you take that 67 body, which, by the way, I believe is the best. I think a lot of people would agree, if you're going to take one, that's the one with the stinger hood. It's the one that has all the kind of cool features that you want. But how you take that body, which is narrower, onto what seems like a wider chassis of all the newer things. Because it seems like if you just put that on, the wheels would stick out about 6 inches on each side or something. Am I missing that? Or
No, you're right. What we did was to expand the size of that car in the computer. We were actually able to morph it a bit after we did the design work on it. I actually built a prototype, a smaller unit, and then we were able to take that scan and expand it. But it not only had to be lengthened, it had to be widened, and it had to be deepened a bit to fit over. If you look at the shape of a new Corvette or any of the newer type sports cars, they're all a wedge type car. They're pointy in the front, low to the ground, that holds them down to the ground, and then they get bigger in the back. Whereas if you look at the original Stingray cars, they were pretty level all the way through. The front is just the same height as the back, and they were just a straight platform. So there was quite a bit of work that had to be done there to get it to look right and to fit around that chassis as well as I got it to do it.
So you took the styling of that 67, but it sounds like what you guys did is you engineered that style and then made it do what it had to do to fit that body. So
absolutely.
Did you make it from scratch?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, so we had to re-engineer. All the door widths are larger so that they're easier to get in and out of the car. The hood is a full tilt front hood, so it's easy to access all the peripheral equipment of the original car. Most of your oil filler, washer bottles, things like that are outside the range of a normal hood opening on the Corvettes, except for the newer ones where they widen the width. But on the original Corvettes, there's no way that you could access that. So I made it a full tilt front end. And then to keep the weight down on this, as far as the lift of the front end, we went to an all-carbon fiber product called Sprint. And we manufacture everything. We vacuum form. We have to cure in an oven. We manufacture everything up at our shop and then assemble it. We do all of our own paint work, upholstery work.
This doesn't sound like old backyard Johnny.
No.
Who just went in a barn and started pasting stuff together with fiberglass to kind of make something happen. I mean, there's a lot of correct engineering that went into all this.
It took me years to develop. I started with my 62 model, and this we're going on 15 years now of being in this and collecting equipment and expanding what I do on the cars. I farmed out some of the early stuff. I had actually hired Boeing to do my first digital work on my 62 style, and that was rather expensive. And then we hired a couple of aerospace companies in the Seattle area to do all of our molds for us. And again, that was very expensive. So through the years, I have added my own equipment, five-axis machines, computer systems, scanning equipment. We do all of our own, like I said, curing in our own ovens. So I've taken what started out to be the idea of a small hobby just to have a little bit of fun, and have taken it now to where it's almost out of control for me.
So the thing I'm curious is, it seems like when you put something like that together, it could be popular. It's the kind of car that you could put out there, and not only would somebody want to buy it from you now, because that's what I'm dreaming about, that's what I want, seems like that could start to be a list, and somebody could actually maybe want you to redo that for them. Have you guys had any thought about the idea of reproducing what you just created then? Or
Yes, we have. And in fact, we're doing that now with all of our models. And we've made this. Building a car, a one-off car, is a little different project. I've built a number of cars that I've shown here at the Roadster Show and other shows. And it's a little different than building a car that's totally different in size, shape, and operation as far as openings and hoods and gasket materials, things like that, and make it dependable, make it so that it'll work time and time again. We can open and close these hoods 100, 1,000 times, and they still will latch and close correctly. And a lot of cars you can't do that to. You do a few times and something breaks because you haven't stressed it out and engineered it quite correctly. And it's quite a bit different challenge to build a car that you can replicate and make it dependable so people can count on it versus just building a one-off, this is how I want to do this one.
I noticed when looking at it close that you guys really perfected the seams. Now, obviously, that's an advantage, and we're living in an age where technology will aid with that, yeah. But you guys, the quality on it, perfect. I mean, everything looks symmetrical. I mean, all the seams spot on right where they need to be. Better than what they would have been, obviously, in the originals.
Well, as we had talked just a little while ago off camera, nothing's perfect in this world. Even the Riddler cars, you know, we can go through and we can find some little things that may not be quite right. But I've done the best job I can. And again, I can't, trying to replicate these and sell any small quantities of them, you can't do this in that $200,000, $300,000 price range.
Right.
So you've got to get the price down. And in doing that, you have to sacrifice some of the things. But we've been able to kind of make a combination of a very custom, reproducible vehicle here, but yet make it affordable to a lot of people. Not everybody, but to a lot of people.
Well, one of the things I'll try and do, and we'll attach to this interview, is I want to be able to get photos from you and things so we can actually show you know, the build parts of it, maybe even some of the diagrams that, you know, you put together for it. But the big thing I know about this car after having seen it is that, and this shows are like this in general, this is another one of those cars that you got to come down to the show when you know it's going to be there and actually look at it in person to see, because there's way too many details. I mean, yeah. we're missing so much. The closer I looked in the car, the more stuff I found that I wasn't expecting. And we could sit here for hours going through those kind of details. What would you say are the most unique kind of different things that you ran into about it in trying to maybe keep it similar or deciding to go away and to stay with new?
Well, I think obviously trying to make the car egressible so that you can get in and out of it, because the older I know I got, it was tougher to get into these cars, and especially on the old Corvettes where the steering wheel is right there in your face and your head is above the top of the windshield, and it's just it's tough to take those kinds of cars on a long trip and consider them dependable. That's one of the reasons that I stayed with the windshield system and the windows and the gaskets and the things from the new car, is because it's all been proven. It's a very dependable system. It seals up. The top doesn't leak. You can go to any Chevy garage and buy a new hinge or a latch or a door striker or whatever you need 10 years, 15, 20 years from now. There's a few custom parts on the thing that we produce because of the way something hinges or has to move, you know, is a little bit different. And so we produce those. But again, we have the drawings, we have the specs on them. We can reproduce those things now or whoever is doing this 20 years from now.
The windshield was one of the things I noticed that you could noticeably, if you know those cars, you noticed that was different because it would stand up straighter and not be leaned quite so much. And it looks like yours is, it looks like it's lower too. So it seems like you did have quite a challenge then, being able to get it in where you're not getting in sitting on the ground, yet still, you know, being tall enough to be able to see and still have a windshield that goes over your head. You had a lot of stuff to try and figure out there.
I did, and it was interesting. Dave Hill is a good acquaintance of mine. Dave Hill was the chief engineer of Chevrolet Corvette. He's the father of the C5, C6 Corvette. And he and I have talked in length about the car and kind of joked a little bit about how I would tackle a provision on the car. I would have to figure out how much strength it would take to lift the hood up in a given different levels. And I used a broomstick and a bathroom scale. And then I charted it out and then calculated it that way. And of course, Dave Hill just asked one of his engineers to write a program and come up with a number. So, I always believe that there is more than one way to get anywhere in life. And that includes building a car. I mean, I think what we've created there is just, it's been a very dependable, easy ride. It gets great looks. It's been holding its value in the 13 years that I've had some of these cars out there. We've never had a recall on them for a crack or an issue in the paint or anything. It's just, I do have a warranty on these things, but virtually we never have to use it because the things have just like the Chevrolet Corvettes, they're pretty much bulletproof anymore.
That's what I loved about mine. Never had a single issue in all those years I said that I owned them. Not a single issue.
Yeah.
So obviously this is an effort that takes a lot more than one person. Now you have, and I kind of want to know who's doing what in the company to do these things, and what's your role then in the company to make that happen?
Well, on the first model that I did everything myself in the garage. And in my own garage, I bought an old frame rack to give myself a level platform to work off of. I bought a brand new 2001 Corvette, a C5, and then I bought aftermarket panels for a 62 Corvette. And I started actually taping those panels onto PVC pipe and stuff to configure it size-wise. I had to cut and slice and lift here and push there and get it kind of configured visually, and that took me 7 months. I then hired Boeing to come down on that first car, and they digitally scanned with $1 million scanner that they brought to my garage, and they scanned that model, and it was only half of the model. It was the driver's side. And then I reluctantly removed all those body panels because I had spent all that time developing it. Once I took them off, trying to get them right back there again would have been tough. So, but I did cut them all off, and then they scanned the mounting points that I had identified on the original chassis I was using. And then over a 13, 14 month period, working together with two or three of their computer design people, we developed a complete computer model of that car where we could open and close the doors and hoods and all the components of the car and make sure that everything fit. We ran into a few small issues that we were able to fix in the computer before they actually went to hard parts. Then we used that data to run CNC machines to cut master plugs, make the bowls off the plugs, and we were off and running.
I was trying to figure out how you go about getting that level, because everything seemed like it was engineered to such a high degree that you would have to get a hold of people like you did. And how do you get people like that to commit to a project? You go all in like you did. You went out and bought a new car, and then you started taking stuff apart on it. I not your average dude goes out and does that. I mean, that took a little.
I sometimes get more involved in the hobby than I probably should have. And the whole idea of this for me was to be a hobby. I was a Budweiser wholesaler for 31 years, and we were selling the distributorship, and I just didn't want to retire, and I've always loved to play with cars, but I hadn't for a number of years, so I thought this would be a fun project to get involved in. So I built the first car. We took it to the SEMA show, and we introduced it at SEMA. And Boeing was so pleased at how well the first car came out that they actually paid for the booth there at SEMA for me to exhibit the car.
Wow.
And two of their top people went with me to the show, and we had 10 people in the booth. We got 43 orders at that show. And I had gone with the intent of just seeing if there was any interest in the card, not to sell anything, because we weren't prepared. I actually hadn't even developed a price yet for the card. So after the first night of getting, we got 11 orders the first day, went back to the hotel room and got out my laptop and started kind of, well, I can do this for this much and this for that much. Came up with a price, and by the end of the show, we had 43 orders on paper. Got back, I had no employees, I had no shop, I had one car that I built in my garage. So you can imagine it was hysteria.
The flailing, you know, to build a team.
Yeah. So it took me 18 months to get the people together, get a shop built out. I bought all brand new paint booth equipment and built out a shop. Never having been in this business before, I made a few mistakes along the way there as far as equipment. I mean, I did an overkill on everything, but we got the job done in 18 months. I honestly lost almost all the orders that we originally got because people aren't going to wait a year, 2 years to get their car. So, but the next show we went to, we filled it right back up again. So for the first 3 or 4 years of being in business, there was no problem. I went to one show a year, the SEMA show. We got all the orders we could handle for that year. In fact, the cup was overflowing until the economy crunch. But again, I had overstepped what I really had in mind for this whole project. It was going to be a small shop with 2 or 3 guys working for me, build a couple cars, have some fun. I ended up with 23 employees, and we were pushing for 50 cars a year. And
wow. It changes your whole role in it, too. You go from real hands-on into everything. Now, all of a sudden, you're the guy who's spending the time writing out paperwork and this.
Well, I kind of lost sight of where I wanted to be in this thing. I wanted this to have fun. I had been in a real business for 31 years. I'd been managing that business for about 15 years and responsible for a lot of it. And we had 176 employees at the Budweiser shop. So I was kind of through with that kind of a ride. And so about 2 years ago, I finally just said, it's just not worth it for me anymore. So I decided to tone things down. I'm now down. I've got 8 employees. We do a car every 3 weeks, which is perfect. I can do a couple, 2 or 3 shows a year. And it's very comfortable for me. I can get out. I can have some fun. I can take a little time when I want to. You know, I went from a 5-day-a-week job to a 6 or 7-day-a-week job in retirement.
And don't work. That don't last either.
No, it doesn't. But I've been doing that for 13 years.
So how many days you cut down to now? Is life where it needs to be? And
I'm
kind of half.
I'm usually
that?
At 6 days now. I do take Sundays off now. But I pretty much work 6 days, but I love it. I just really do. And my real passion is in the engineering side of things. I'm not a true engineer. I did take engineering at Portland State here, and I never got a degree in it. But I understand enough of it that I can usually figure things out. And I'm pretty creative. I like to think I think out of the box when it comes to a lot of our issues and problems and things we have to figure out. And I'm always looking for new things that we can add to what we're doing to make them better, more dependable, kind of that new spark, you know. You're always looking at the car you're driving, and when it comes to buy a new car, you know, you want a new ashtray, or you want a new radio, or you want some reason to buy that new car. Mm-hmm. If it's identical to what you've already got, there's no sense in changing.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's amazing. Well, it excites me. I mean, I see that and I want to hook up with you and go out and play. I mean, I cannot believe how cool that car is. Well, you did a great job on it. I thank you so much for coming in today and being able to share it with us.
My pleasure. I appreciate it very much.
Thanks, Doug.
Yeah.
Thank you guys all, and we'll see you next time.